Good morning. 'Tis a gift to worship with the Unitarian Universalist Church of Ventura. I am Worship Associate Jim Merrill. Our minister, the Reverend Dana Warsnop, is away today. We are joined by one of our favorite speakers, the Reverend Dr. Tom Owen-Towle, to whom I will introduce you in just a moment. We are thankful for our fabulous worship collaborative. Today, Celia Ortenberg and I are the worship associates, with music director Carolyn Bjerke and magic images by Neil Ortenberg. Brian Fortune is directing, with Kitty Merrill as assistant director. Our coordinator of religious education, Fidelity Balmer, facilitated Children's Chapel earlier this morning and has provided background support for today's story for all ages. Our tech support human is Joe Osborne, reached by phone or chat. He'll post his number. Here's something to be aware of. The final session of our program fair is Sunday at 12:30 today. Sue Brinkmeyer and Celia Ortenberg have prepared a great presentation for us on worship activities. The topics include choir, greeter, magic, tech support, and worship associates. We're posting the link for that in the chat. And if that goes by too fast, you can also find the link in Thursday's UUCV this week. We are pleased to welcome the Reverend Dr. Tom Owen-Towle to our pulpit today. He was ordained in 1967 and is still preaching hither and yon throughout our Pacific Southwest district. When the pandemic is over, Tom will return to his community commitments, volunteering at the homeless center, singing in nursing homes, and mentoring young people. He's always delighted to be the guest minister of our Ventura congregation, in person or via Zooming. Now, let us enter sacred space.
Good morning. I'm Celia Ortenberg, and I hope everyone today has a chalice or a candle and something to light it with. Let's all light our chalices together in honor of the holy light at the core of each of us and the love and hope that link us all.
Our call to worship this morning comes from Norman Cousins. The capacity for hope is the most significant fact in life. It provides humans with a sense of destination and the energy to get started.
Good morning, I'm Carolyn Bjerke, the music director, and I'd like to invite you to join in singing with me our opening hymn, Come Sing a Song with Me.
Bring you home when home is hard to find, and I
Our coordinator of religious education, Fidelity Balmer, recommended today's story. Usually when we have a storybook, one of us from church will read it ourselves. Today though, we have a video from a group in Bengaluru, also known as Bangalore, in southern India. So the voice we're going to hear is Southern Indian. I chose to keep this audio in honor of and tribute to the late Shyamala Gopalan Harris, who was also from Southern India, not too far from where we got this video. Who, some of you may ask, was Shyamala? She was the mother of our Vice President of the United States. Now, let's hear our story.
Hello everyone. So the book that we're reading today is A Child's Garden, A Story of Hope. And it's written by Michael Forman. The boy saw it after a night of rain, a speck of green in the rubble, peeping up towards the sunlight. He moved some broken bricks so that nothing would fall and crush the tiny plant. He didn't know what sort of plant it was, a flower or a weed. He just knew it would struggle to survive. The boy searched around and found an old can which held a little rainwater. He brought it to the plant. "Drink up," he whispered. "Drink up." The sun was climbing in the sky, and the boy gave the plant shade with some old sacking and wire. The boy's world was a place of ruin and rubble, ringed by a fence of barbed wire. In the hot, dry summer, the air was thick with dust. Faraway hills shimmered in the haze. The boy knew that cool streams flowed in those hills. He used to go there with his father, but now the hills were the wrong side of the wire. Over the following weeks, he cared for his secret garden. Soon, the green tendrils reached to the high barbed wire fence. Now, the boy could tell it was a vine, a grapevine. It spread along the fence and gave shade to its own tender roots, which, in turn, sent out more shoots. Birds and butterflies came bringing seeds and pollen on their wings. The garden grew. It was no longer a secret. Friends came to sit in its shade, and it became a playground for the children. See how beautiful this has become? All so colorful, and such colorful birds and butterflies. Then, one day, soldiers came and destroyed everything. They threw the vine in a ditch on the other side of the wire. The boy thought his heart would break. Winter came. The boy and his family shivered in the cold and damp of their ruined home. Spring came late. After the first night of rain for weeks, the boy noticed green shoots all along the ditch. Some seeds from his vine must have survived the winter. He worried about the new shoots. He couldn't get close enough to water them. They were on the other side of the wire. Then, one evening, he saw a little girl playing by the ditch. She had a bucket and she was sprinkling water on the tiny plants. Each evening she returned. The boy hoped the soldiers wouldn't notice. But they didn't seem to mind plants growing on their side of the fence. Then one day the boy saw tiny specks of green peeping from the rubble where his garden had been. "Look," he yelled, "come and see. My wine has come back. He began collecting water and once more tended his garden. Soon it reached the wire where it became entwined with the green tendrils from the little girl's side. The barbed wire disappeared under leafy shade and the new garden became home once more to birds and butterflies. Let the soldiers return, thought the boy. Roots are deep and seeds spread. One day, the fence will disappear forever and we will be able to walk again into the hills. The end.
Roots are deep and seeds spread. The boy and girl live on opposite sides of a fence in some place. It could be any place where anger has temporarily overcome love, but hanging in there, and even the smallest gestures, like watering a sprout, show how hope and care can eventually succeed.
Thank you, Jim. Sunday, this congregation gives away our collection to an organization in the larger community or to funds to help people in our own church. We invite you to donate online. You'll see the link on the next slide. Which will also be posted on the chat as a direct link. Our offering today goes to the Ventura Homeless Prevention to keep Ventura City residents from being evicted because a short-term loss or work or major of work or major medical or car repair bill has made them temporarily unable to pay their rent. Here are three families that they helped last month. Krista and her kids had been surviving during the pandemic on her unemployment benefits. Then she received word that her benefits had ended. They were restored on appeal, but in the meantime, she had used up all her savings and had no way to pay rent. Elizabeth had been unable to work for months due to COVID. And by the time she was finally able to go back to work, she'd fallen behind in rent and needed assistance to help her qualify for eviction protections. And Tricia was suddenly unable to pay her rent when her roommate moved out without paying, and she needed help that month until her new roommate could move in. In each case, Ventura Homeless Prevention paid the required rent, and the family stayed housed. With so many people affected by the pandemic, your help has never been more important. Thank you for giving generously, as you always do, and helping to keep people housed.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own two hands, with my own, with my own. I can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. Make it a brighter place with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a safer place. With my own two hands, I'm gonna help the human race. With my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. I can hold you in my own two hands, and I can comfort you with my own two hands. But you got to use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands. Use your own, use your own two hands. With our own, with our own two hands. With our own.
Was beautiful, wasn't it? We are always deeply grateful for the generosity of this congregation. Your gifts are golden threads that run throughout this community and keep us connected to one another and to the broader world. Thank you.
Each week, we lift up the joys and sorrows that have been shared with our community. You can submit a joy and or sorrow to be shared through the link in UUCV this week or through the joys and sorrows link on our website, uuventura.org. 10 p.m. Saturday is the cutoff for sharing the next day. When we are together in our physical sanctuary, we drop stones and water for each joy or sorrow. The ripples that go out represent the ways in which a joy or sorrow that touches the heart of one of us travels throughout our community to touch us all. Today, the ripples we see on our screens are virtual, but we know the connections they represent are still very real. I invite you now to speak aloud or in your heart the names of those you wish to celebrate or memorialize, or those who may need the loving embrace of this community. By invoking their names, we bring them into this circle of caring that we create here together. We hold these names, spoken and unspoken, in the silent sanctuary of our hearts. May we be truly grateful for all that is our life.
It's my joy to return to be with you, even if it's via Zoom. And I had almost forgotten that I've been in the Ventura congregation one way or another since the 70s. Ron Cook, Frederica Lepore, Dick Weston Jones, on. Your core of ministers and lay leaders. I want to thank particularly today, before I do the reading, Reverend Dana, for inviting me to be in your midst. Without that invitation, guests don't appear. And I want to thank Jim and Kitty Merrill and her whole squad of Zoom cadets. What a wonderful team you have. And I know it's my faith that it's my hope, it's my prayer that we will be in person together sometime, if not in 2021, in 2022. The reading I've selected today is from our poet laureate, Amanda Gorman, and I'm going to share excerpts from her exceptional poem. somehow we've weathered and witnessed a nation that isn't broken, but simply unfinished. We are striving to forge a union with purpose, to compose a country committed to all cultures, colors, characters, and conditions of humanity. And so we lift our gaze, not to what stands between us, but what stands before us. We close the divide because we know to put our future first. We must first put our differences aside. We lay down our arms so that we can reach out our arms to one another. One thing is certain, if we merge mercy with might and might with right, then love becomes our legacy. The new dawn blooms as we free it, for there is always light if only we're brave enough to see it, if only we're brave enough to be it. Please join me in moments of prayer and silent communion. Spirit of eternal love and life and liberation, our prayer is simple. Be our holy companion as we struggle to create a more just and healing and joyful world. We especially call upon thy spirit to comfort those individuals who are suffering from the pandemic, from economic inequities, from racial violence, from fires, from the death of loved ones, who are suffering and need comfort. And for those who are in a place of joy and elation, be their companion as well. Celebrate with them. And for those who are struggling with despond or blah, give them a nudge. Give them some hope. And may there be peace and unrest in all of our lives. Unrest and peace, sufficient peace to bring us serenity and calm. And enough unrest to keep us spiritually awake and morally responsive. Peace and unrest. Unrest and peace. Shalom, salam, ashe, and amen. Thank you. Yes, after days of rain here in San Diego, here comes the sun. And if we're going to embody the words of inaugural poet laureate Amanda Gorman in the days ahead in our homeland, we will need, as she urges, to merge mercy with might and might with right, so love can become our legacy. And to do so, my friends, we will need to fill our souls with deep and expansive and genuine hope. The Apostle Paul said, faith, hope, and love abide, and the greatest of these is love. Well, my friends, they're all great. They're all critical. But hope, the unsung virtue of the three, dare not get lost in the shuffle. For we can't keep faith nor share love if we're not brimming with durable hope. Hope means believing in spite of the evidence and watching the evidence change. No, make that helping the evidence change. Every morning you want to launch the day with a full dose of hopefulness. You want to make sure that you choose the team of hopers rather than the squad of cynics. Hopers unite. Now, I'm not suggesting that the world's problems are solved, far from it. But good and hopeful news too frequently slips beneath our radar screens and social media nowadays. And it's the job of those of us who belong to a genuinely life-affirming, this-worldly, hopeful faith, such as Unitarian Universalism, to stand tall and to shout forth items of good news. Or as Buddhist comedian Wes Nisker puts it, if you don't like the news, then go out and make some yourself. I mean, did you realize that the fact that although the world's population has doubled between 1960 and 2000, the rate of growth is now declining. Families on every continent are having fewer children. And in the past 30 years, the global average fertility rate has fallen from 6 children per woman to 2.8 children per woman. Now that's hopeful news, folks. And what about food? Fewer people are malnourished today than in 1970 because global food production has grown faster than the population. Again, hopeful news. And literacy in the developing world has jumped from 47% in 1970 to 70% today, meaning that many more people have tools to improve their standard of living. Certainly something to crow about. I know negative stats exist as well, particularly in the underdeveloped lands. And certainly things often seem dire and desperate right here in our very own homeland. But friends, don't forget the positive truths. It soothes the soul to know that progress isn't a pipe dream. Progress is a genuine possibility when people put their hearts and minds into making the world a more just and joyful place. When you and I don't just make wishes to launch the year, but embody resolves. And so I ask, what dreams, both private and public, even during the pandemic, are you realizing in your daily life today on January 31st, 2021? Are you saying yes to love more genuinely those near and dear to you? Are you saying yes to greater mercy and justice wherever you move and have your being? Are you saying yes to one world family, to a planet at peace, to the well-being of all existence everywhere? Try saying yeses aloud every day. Yeses from the heart. And watch some of your yeses take wings and become more real than you could ever imagine. Yes, I can. Yes, we can. As a Unitarian Universalist, you've consciously thrown your lot with an unrelentingly hopeful faith. And by hope, I'm not referring to optimism. The optimist tends to be fanciful and dreamy-eyed, often leaving the world's problems up to George or God, Georgette or Goddess, to solve while remaining a bouncy, mindless cheerleader on the sidelines. The optimist resembles a person who gazes at the stars, but is perennially at the mercy of puddles in the road. Instead, the hoper isn't convinced that something will happen, but is willing to work his or her rear off to make sure that it might just come to be. The optimist lays back. The hoper moves forward. The hoper is an activated human being, one who arouses in self and others a passion for the possible. A passion for the possible. Hopers stay on purpose even when not immediately successful. Now, the hoper differs from the pessimist as well as the optimist. Realism would often demand pessimism. But the hopeful person talks not in terms of crisis, a concept that usually overwhelms and immobilizes us, but in terms of issues and challenges and jobs with our names on some of them. You see, everything grows more manageable when reduced to doable tasks. Hope arouses passion for the possible. Hopers know that the best antidepressant on the market involves movement of mouth, movement of body, movement of conscience, movement of heart, moving outside our self-pity or despond to connect with the larger world in specific deeds of deep kindness and hope. Cynicism is all around us. In fact, in recent times, what I call a new sort of progressive cynicism, if you will, has arisen. Progressive cynics harbor the conviction that Western culture and American society are hopelessly oppressive. Now, I would agree, as one rounding into my 80th year, that our culture is drenched in racism and sexism and homophobia and a whole array of interlinking oppressions. I know that we have to work daily to keep a civil war from reoccurring in America. But we Unitarian Universalists have joined Hopers United. And we believe that cynicism is spiritual treason. We harbor a bias that leads us to assert that no problem in human relations is ever truly insoluble. Now, we may never solve it in our lifetimes, but you and I belong to a religion that refuses to quit on justice, quit on mercy, quit on civilization. We keep on keeping on because we're incurable hopers. In counseling, whenever someone felt despondent, the best therapeutic advice I could ever muster was to help break down their seemingly monstrous malaise into manageable units, and then to locate one or two relatively easy beginning assignments, actions they might successfully achieve in order to nibble away at their misery. No one ever left my office without homework. The tasks could be small. They usually were, seemingly inconsequential, but slowly and surely a breakthrough might emerge. For when we're weary and beaten down, it's wise for us to do small rather than think big, to take a step rather than fantasize a leap. Of course, we can't say or bear everything, but we can say some things, and we can bear a lot, and we must. If not now, when? If not us, who? Remember, my siblings, the core doctrine of our Unitarian heritage is semper reformanda, always reforming and being reformed. It means that you and I can evolve and grow and change spiritually all our days and nights on earth. That's good news. Here's a personal example. In my men's soulful and prophetic work since 1973, and I know you've had men's groups there in Ventura, and I hope they're still thriving. I've invariably employed as shorthand the self-identification of WHAM. That is white, heterosexual, Anglo-American, able-bodied, middle-class male. And as a member of WHAM, I've been a lifelong carrier of unearned privilege and power, and must labor daily to disrupt, if not dismantle, my own condition. And to do so, I've added an ER, ever reforming, semper reformanda, to my identity and have become a whammer. To be sure, as a home stretch elder, as a whammer, my seasons are numbered, yet they are currently filled with growing faith and hope and love. I mean, despite our 400 years of virulent, intractable racism, I perceive shining sparks of promise, don't you? I mean, the protests throughout America and abroad in response to the murder of African Americans have been essentially peaceful and purposeful. And they're not only transpiring in cities, but in rural communities as well. And these rallies and marches are bursting with greater numbers of whites and younger folks than ever before. Surfers, med students, skateboarders, and corporate lawyers are joining hands for greater police reform in laid-back San Diego. You see, this newer activist generation, they're signing on as lifers. This isn't a task force. They're signing on as lifers in hot and deep pursuit of forging once and for all a multiracial, more inclusive democracy. And the soul of this grizzled civil rights veteran whose very life was changed when marching in Selma back in 1965 is surging with positivity as fresh troops of moral lieutenants are fighting anti-blackness with righteous rage. And recently, within the span of 1 week, there was the hopeful news of the first in a series of lawsuits siding with the Standing Rock tribal sovereignty in opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline. And then some surprising Supreme Court support of the rights of dreamers and LGBTQIA plus folks. And note the unstinting commitment and daily labor of our new administration to heal the divisions in our country and forge anew. As Amanda said, we're unfinished. tiny, awkward steps. But nonetheless, these are steps forward. Semper reformanda. More good news to report. Our granddaughter, Corinne, is currently teaching English as a second language in South Korea, is waking up as well. And here's been a portion of the passionate letter she penned after the most recent police murders of Black Americans. Hey, Graham and Gramp, why haven't I been outraged my entire life? It's taken me 22 years to discover the verb in activism. It's a word that requires action. It's taken me this long to find that being an ally isn't synonymous with being not racist. And all I can really say to these realizations is thank goodness it didn't take me a moment longer. 2020 will be the year that we woke up. Corinne. Oh, dear granddaughter, your fearlessness is palpable. We can feel your energy toward restructuring the soul of your native soil. And Corinne, there's no need to apologize that you're getting truth at the age of 22. John Lewis at the age of 21 signed on as one of the original freedom writers, spent 34 years as a conscience of Congress and was writing legislation to secure voters' rights the week before he died at the age of 80. Yes, Corinne, you are choosing, starting right now, like Brother John, to get into good, necessary trouble and to become a lifer for greater freedom and justice for all. Ever onward, Corinne. Semper reformanda, in the name of love, join forces with Sister Amanda. Simply stay woke. Stay woke. So my fellow UUs, I'm urging you to choose the team of hopers, starting here and starting now, to embody hope, to be hope whenever and wherever your name's called, for hope's the central imperative of your and my chosen faith. And hope is the power that keeps us awake and vital. Imagine three candles burning slowly. The ambience is so soft, you can hear the candles speak. And the first candle says, I am faith, but these days I'm no longer indispensable. And then faith's flame slowly diminishes and dies out. The second candle pipes up, I'm love, and I no longer have the strength to stay lit. People fail to understand my power, reducing me to schmaltz and syrup. And waiting no longer, the candle of love weakens and then goes out completely. Suddenly a child enters a room and the two candles no longer burning. She sees them. She begins to weep and wail. Faith and love, why aren't you burning? You're supposed to stay lit until the very end. I can't find my way without the two of you. And then a third candle speaks gently yet firmly to the little girl. Don't be afraid, my child, for I am hope. And while I still burn, we can relight the other two candles. For whenever the candle of hope remains aglow, there's enough candle power to light faith and to light love throughout our homes and our homeland and the globe. Oh, yes, there is. You bet there is enough power to light faith and light love. May it come to pass 70% of the time. Shalom. Salam. Ashe. Namaste. And amen.
Thank you so much, Reverend Tom, for that inspiring message of hope. Please join me in singing our closing hymn, Gather the Spirit.
As our service comes to an end, we extinguish our chalices, but not the light of faith, the warmth of community, the fire of commitment, or the candle of hope. After the benediction, you'll be invited to breakout rooms for a virtual coffee hour. You can join your group or opt out at that point. Even if you are new to us, and especially if you're new to us, we sincerely invite you in. Reverend Tom will join us today in one of our breakout rooms. If you'd like to meet with him, you can decline your invitation to your assigned breakout room and ask to be moved into a room with our guest minister. Basically, you'll be staying in the main room, and you can at that point raise your hand to let Kitty know that you'd like to be moved into the breakout room with Reverend Tom. Or if you just hang out there for a while, you'll get moved there automatically.
Our words for our benediction come from the splendid author, Barbara Kingsolver. The very least we can do in our life is figure out what we hope for. And the most we can do is live inside that hope.